Morning. Another week, another tragedy, another series of tragedies. And we're looking at again the world as it is, trying to come to grips with it, trying to see what God's answer is to this world and his promise that there is a freedom from this world. I want to start with two quotes today. First from Wall Street Journal, second is from a man named George Weigel. It was actually in a foreword to a book. The article from the Wall Street Journal says, from the author, "For the first time in my 72 years, I have no idea what is going on. The most important thing in our culture is not change, but the fact that reality itself is dwindling, fading like sun-struck wallpaper. Facebook enshrines banality. We have individualism, but no privacy. We are all outsiders with no inside to be outside of. There is no arc, no through line, no destiny. We are here because we're here because we're here," is what we sing. "Will organized religion die? I got to talking to a girl in an Episcopalian youth group. Episcopalianism is great," she said. "You don't have to believe anything. Like many people, I used to think the world would go on as it would go on with the arrival of better medicines, maybe an iPad, and the occasional earthquake. But that was when I thought I knew what was going on. Now I fear reality is fading like the Cheshire cat, leaving behind only a smile that grows ever more alarming." Second quote says that we live in a world that has lost its story, a world in which the progress promised by the humanities of the past three centuries is now gravely threatened by understandings of the human person that reduce us, our humanity, to just a congeries of cosmic chemical accidents. We are a humanity with no intentional origin, no noble destiny, and thus no path to take through history. As we come today to look at the world, we're going to focus on the patterns of the world, or the way that the world works. This is distinct from its temptations or its desires or its lust, which is what we're going to talk about next week. But no matter where you come from, no matter what your orientation is or your worldview or your religious background, the thing that's indisputable if you come today, and I think it's indisputable in our world outside of this building, is that the world is broken. Amen? And we look around the news, and it's undeniable. You might think things are getting better. You might think things are getting worse. But as they are right now, they're not as they should be. The news tells us that on a minute-by-minute basis. And so the questions that we have are important questions. How did the world get this way? Can it be fixed? And if so, can we fix it or someone greater than us fix it? How did it get this way? Can it be fixed? Who's going to fix it? But as important as those questions are, we have a more important question that we're trying to look at today, which is exactly what is wrong with the world. We know it's broken. Before we think about the remedy, what exactly is broken about it? Some of that seems obvious, seems self-evident. But no matter what your stripe, I see across the media today people decrying racism, for example. Racism is awful, and it is. And they're offering solutions to this cure, offering solutions to cure us and cure our society of racism. But what I haven't heard in all of these discussions is, why is racism bad in the first place? Why is it actually bad? Well, we know that people should be treated equally. But if we are time plus matter plus chance, where did that idea even come from? Who told us that we're supposed to be treated equal? Wait, because it says all men were created equal. Where did that come from? And whether that is standard, and we can just say that's a norm of humanity, we all should expect universally to be treated equally. Even if that's a given, even if that's true, it doesn't explain how racism got here. How are otherwise intelligent, nice, educated, upstanding people still racist in their hearts, including me? And I think you, if you're honest. How did it get there? That's what our media is not explaining. Is our world's biggest problem just ignorance? If so, then we need education. But since the civil rights movement, we've had education on this. And that's where people are throwing their hands up, because it seems nothing has really changed. We haven't really explained why and what exactly is broken about the world. That's what we're trying to do today. And I think that into this confusion, into these questions, is an opportunity for us as Christians. Because we have this great story to a people that have lost their story. We have the great story, the great good news. And our great good news is not just that we know why the world is broken and we're not confused about that, but that we can say to this world that's scratching its head, that's throwing its arms up, throwing its fist up, do you know the story? Do you know the story, the great story? Do you know the story of the Bible, that there is a world that is broken and there's this amazing truth that God is coming to remake it, that has come to fix it and set it right? If we said to these people, I want to share with you a story about how God sets us free from ourselves, from the patterns of this world, from the greatest evil that's within me, from the greatest evil that's outside of me. He not only forgives me, but he sets me free to actually not be a slave to the ideologies of this world, to the patterns of this world, to its racism, to its sexism, to its power plays. And I also actually get to be in this dynamic, flourishing, amazing relationship with the creator of the universe. You want to hear that story? Brothers and sisters, I think we are surrounded by people, I know I am, that aren't engaged with Christianity that way. They haven't heard it that way. They haven't been presented that way. That here's a story that explains everything. Here's a story of a God who sets you free. Not a God waiting in heaven for you to get your act right, and then he'll let you into heaven. But a God that cares about this world, who created this world, who has liberated this world. You know, long before our day, a long time ago, the Times of London sent out this famous question, our question, to a group of thinkers and writers. What's wrong with the world? Sent this out in England. And by far the shortest answer came from a Christian thinker who wrote back to the newspaper, what's wrong with the world? I am yours, C.K. Chesterton. His answer was, I am. What's wrong with the world? Me. And we know that Christianity's claim is that long ago we walked away from our creator, we walked away from our maker, and in this alienation is the source that we have been alienated from God, his plans, his goodness, his mercy, his purpose, and him. And that this alienation, the separation from God, is the root of the brokenness that we see around us. And from this alienation on us, from the rebellion in heaven of the angels, there came about this alienation of creation from its creator, from the world, from its maker, in revolt. And last time we looked at this question about what is the world. Biblically, this has different definitions. But what it means in general is that the world is not only referring to the way people behave on this planet Earth, but the world is itself an entity. The world is itself a power, a collection of powers, a structure of powers. That when the Bible speaks about the evil of the world, it's an evil that's actually independent of evil people. That there are people who do bad things, who do evil things, but there's a power behind that. That doesn't make people blameless. That doesn't get people off the hook. We can't say the world made me do it. We are people who chose to do evil, and there's also something independent of us that is evil. The story is more complex than what I want to share a slice of, but if we have a picture of this, God gave us a great clue. There was one point that the world was so evil, so bad, that God chose one representative through which to repopulate the earth. And everything was killed in the world. Everything was gone, except for Noah and his family. But we know that within their own generation, within their own family, sin erupted again. The world erupted again. We have this belief that we shared in that poem last week that society is man's problem. And society is the problems of conditions, and conditions are the problem of society. We have this circular argument that goes around, and God shows the picture. I wiped all that away. What happened? He says there's something going on, and that it's controlled by Satan. And as a reality that is apart from Christ and set apart from Christ. That's why Jesus can say, I am not of this world, you are of this world. And what he's saying is not only I came from heaven, my actual origins are not earthly, I'm not just a human. But what he's saying is I am not of this place. Its drives, its manipulations, its patterns are not from me or controlling me or about me. But he looks at people and says, you are from this world, which is why you don't know me, but I am not from it. I'm not characterized by this world. Its character, its essence, its desires, its determination have nothing to do with Jesus. Unlike the world, Jesus tells us that he only listens to the Father, only obeys the Father, only does what he sees the Father doing. He's the only person who can say this and tells us that. Unlike the world's lies, he tells us that he is truth, truth himself. Unlike its confusion, he is the logos. He is the word that makes sense. Against its self-serving, we see Jesus' self-sacrifice. Against its hatred, his love. Against its evil, his righteousness. And brothers and sisters, it's hard to really understand the claims of Jesus, what Jesus is doing, without understanding this picture of the world. And that his kingdom has come into this world to save this world. So we think about that, our famous verse that God so loved the world that Jesus came into it to save it. To save it, to invade it. And what we see is a kingdom of heaven coming into a kingdom of the world to liberate that kingdom, to overpower that kingdom. But not in the way that worldly kingdoms overcome other worldly kingdoms. From the very beginning, John the Baptist is saying that the kingdom of God is here in Jesus Christ. Jesus is saying, I am the king. He goes on parable after parable to explain what the kingdom is like. And his mission is to announce the kingdom, and that as he is the king stepped on earth, the kingdom is here and it's now and it's empowering. And he tells us in Isaiah, I am here as the king, the kingdom here to set people free, to liberate people physically, economically, socially, spiritually. From yourself, from the bondage of sin, and from the world powers that are acting on you. This is what's interesting as you've been reading through the book of Acts. Is this is what you're seeing. Is the kingdom of God is moving forward and overcoming the kingdom of this world. And it's doing it heart at a time and heart at a time. And the patterns of this world and the powers of this world are trying to subjugate it, trying to push back God's kingdom, trying to overcome it. Demonic powers, political powers, cultural powers, racial powers, and it keeps overcoming them and keeps overcoming them. To the point of the chapter that we'll pick up in October of Acts 17, there is a powerful, amazing scene where the Jews want to string up Jason and these apostles. And what they're saying is, these men, they're here. These men who have turned the world upside down have come to us also, and they're trying to turn our world upside down. Many times we use this word to talk about Christianity, that we're turning the world upside down. I encourage you through this series, the reason we're calling it Right Side Up is that the world upside down is what actually non-Christians were saying Christians were doing. And what they're saying is you're upsetting our world, you're disturbing our world, the way it works, our patterns, our own kingdom. You're here to destroy that. And that's exactly what was happening. But when Jesus sent them out in Acts chapter 1, he was sending them out to turn the world right side up. The world has been upside down. But what these people are saying to the Christians, the reason that they want to string them up, when they're saying you're turning the world upside down, it means that you're disturbing it, you're upsetting us, but it's an idiom for treason, sedition. You are betraying us and our system and our world. Your brother said, do you see that's the way the world responds to Christ? Not merely we don't like you, we disagree with you. You are ruining our way of life. You are committing treason against our pattern, our way, our livelihood, our worldview. And that's why I think Galatians is a good place for us to start, because as we're trying to analyze what's going on with the world, we think about, we have to see the world for what it really is. And what Galatians tells us, what Paul is telling us, that there is a spiritual dimension here to these patterns of the world, to this reality. And Paul's writing to this church in Galatia, and he's telling them about grace, about the way God works, but how they are choosing to go back to the way that the world works. Not only its sins and its temptations, but they're falling victim to the powers of this world. And he tells them that there's somebody that's coming in their church, or there's people that are coming to their church and spreading these lies and this false gospel, getting them to act what they were actually set free from. And it's like this yeast that is pervasive and sometimes undetectable, and it's moving throughout to pull people away from God back into the world and the patterns of the world. And the reason this is important is because he's talking to a church. He's talking to people that are Christians. And he's talking to two audiences. He's talking to Jewish believers in Jesus Christ and Gentile believers in Jesus Christ that are in the same church. And in many ways, what he's saying to them is the same, but there's a nuance that's different about the patterns that they're following or falling back into. But his overall message to them is, you are free in Jesus Christ. Why are you going back into the world this way? And we see Paul's pastor heart, what keeps a lot of pastors up late at night, is not writing sermons, but concerned about the people in the church. Do you know how free you are? Will you live in this freedom? Let's take a look at the book of Galatians. What we started with last time was chapter 5, verse 1, and kind of our theme. We're going to go back to chapter 4. For freedom, Christ has set us free. He's telling them again, stand firm, therefore, against these false teachings, against these patterns, and do not submit again to the slavery that you were. You were slaves, you're free, don't go back. So take a look with me in chapter 4. And setting this up is some harsh words that came from chapter 3, where he actually says, oh, foolish Galatians. Who has bewitched you? Who has tricked you? Who has lied to you? He says, you were held captive. You were prisoners. Why will you now go back to that? And so in chapter 4, verse 1, let's take a look at this here. He's talking about, in the end of chapter 3, about being heirs of Abraham and what it means to be heirs, and that because Jewish people have been adopted as God's children, because Gentiles have been adopted, the distinctions have been obliterated. The famous verse that there is no distinction between men and women, between Jews and Gentiles. Not that there's no difference, but in God's eyes, there's no preferential treatment to any of those because you have the same adoption. So now he goes on to continue this metaphor, this analogy of being adopted and being an heir, being a child. When you hear son here, ladies, don't be turned off or think this is not about you. Don't feel it's misogynistic. He's talking about the treatment that a first son would get in this culture, now saying that this is available to all of us. So, says, I mean that the heir, as long as he a child, is no different from a slave, though he is the owner of everything. But he is under guardians and managers until the date set by his father. In the same way, we also, when we were children, were enslaved to the elementary principles or elemental spirits of the world. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the spirit of his son into our hearts, the Holy Spirit, crying, Abba, crying, Father, in this intimate relationship with God. And he's setting up a picture here with we, talking about the Jewish believers and Paul identifying himself with them. And so the elemental principles that they're under are different than the elemental principles of the Gentile believers, or these patterns. But some of the motivation, some of the draw is the same. But he has this picture. Imagine you're a millionaire's kid. And this happened in the ancient world. He's using a Roman context and Roman picture here, that you are from a very wealthy family. You're going to inherit a lot of money. But while you're still a child, Actually, you don't have any more power than the slave that's in your house. Actually, you have less freedom because you have these guardians and these tutors and these counselors over you and these expectations about study, about responsibility, about training that the slave actually doesn't have. And you have these until there is a transfer of status, until true sonship, which in the Roman world would be about 14. But about the time that the father also chose, now you are ready. Now you are ready to be a man or be a woman. There was actually a ceremony at this time where they would change clothing into a different kind of toga or different kind of dress. And I even read a story that there was a part of the ceremony where girls would turn in their dolls and boys would turn in their toys to their father to say, I'm no longer a child. There's a transfer here of status, of ability, of responsibility. And Paul is saying that to the Jewish people, you are a chosen people. You had a special calling. But you were under this guardianship of the law. And brothers and sisters, it's not that the law is inferior. It's not that God said, well, that didn't work. I should send my son. I think sometimes we grow up in church and that's how we picture it. But what he's saying is the law did its job. It guarded you, it protected you, and most of all, it revealed to you your such deep sin that you need a Savior. And he said, until the time came that the Father God chose, just like the Roman Father, and appointed and said, now you are ready. So in salvation history, when God's timing was perfect, he said, Jesus is coming now. Not as plan B, but as plan A. Not merely to do away with the law, but to fulfill the law and now change your complete status into sons of God, into children of God. But what he's saying is now Jewish people, Jewish Christians in the church have returned to the law in a worldly way, in a way that fulfills the patterns of this world. They think they can save themselves by this law. They think that Jesus is not enough. That they need to do something, perform something, be something else in addition to that. And their motivation is not the way the law was first given to them, to know God, to be revealed, to call to them. Instead, it is a means in itself, they think, to find life, which is what Jesus had told them. You look in this book trying to find life, but life is me. And they're using this in a pattern of the world. Then he goes on, so you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. So he reasons this pattern. You're a son. If you're a son, you're now an heir. You have an inheritance through God. Formerly, when you did not know God, now when he talks about you here, he's changed to the Gentiles, to the people who are not Jewish. So when you did not know God, you were enslaved to those that by nature are not gods. You worshiped false gods. You were enslaved by these gods, by their promises. But now that you have come to know God, or rather to be known by God, how can you turn back again to the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world? He's using that same word, but now in a Gentile context. The things of the way the world works. Why are you turning back to that? Whose slaves you want to be once more? And instead of legalism, he talks about mysticism. You observe days and months and seasons and years. You fall into superstitions. You fall into the way that the world thinks that the world works, by luck, by chance, by appeasing gods, by some karmic system. And then, tough words from a pastor. I'm afraid I may have labored over you in vain. Paul's exhausted and worn out. I've poured myself. I've suffered. I've sweat for you. But I feel it's a waste because I've come preaching grace. But you want these other things. And the way the world works. So what is he talking about here? When we talk about true freedom, again, we said in Christianity there's a freedom from and there's a freedom to. There's a freedom from our bondage, from sin, from myself, from the world. And here, when he talks about the world, he's talking about that there's a freedom from these elemental principles, these spirits of the world. In verse 8, he calls these gods, which were not gods. But the same word in 3 and 9. He talks about these elemental spirits. Other places that this is important to look in Paul's writing is Colossians, where he says it twice. First in 2:8, he says, "See that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world." More than just men's wrong thinking. Men's wrong thinking motivated, controlled, organized by a system of the world that's beyond it and outside of it. And that these things, again, are not according to Christ, but set up against Christ, against his grace, against his salvation plan, against his purpose and destiny for the world. And then in 2:20, he says, if with Christ you have died to those patterns, not only you don't want to do them anymore, he's saying you don't have to do them anymore. They're not controlling on you. So why go back to these here, legalism, don't handle, don't taste? These are human precepts and teachings. These are connected. The spirit of the age, the spirit of the world, influencing human teaching, human institutions. So let's try to define this a little bit here, what he's talking about. It's complicated, the word, the idea. I warn you today that this is where Paul is actually the most practical in his message. But for some of us saying, wait, just tell me how I should love people. You might feel that this is not practical. But this is super practical, what Paul is trying to say, to explain why the church is the way it is, why the world the way it is. And he says these elemental principles are in a very literal translation. They're the ABCs of life. They're the way basic people know that the world works and say, yeah, everybody knows that. That's the way it works. You might have some intellectual discussion and passionate discussion about why Kevin Durant is coming to the Warriors and why he wants to come here, and you talk all these high terms about legacy and passion and championship, and somebody turns to you and says, in the ABCs of the world, bro, duh, it's money. It's money. Money makes the world go round. It's money. And they break it down. The ABCs of the way life actually works. The drives. The passion. But he's talking about that these are power structures that shape our world, and they shape it through so many different ways. Through politics, economics, government systems, our humanities, the arts, our media, our sports, our way of thinking, our education, the values that we hold as a collective group of people have been shaped and are shaping at the same time the way that the world works. And these are imperceptible for most of us because we are inside of this. Another part that I think is helpful is when in Romans 12:2, some of us know where Paul tells us also, don't be conformed by the world. But here he's not using the word cosmos that he's used in Galatians. He's using another word that means the age, the spirit of the age. Don't be conformed to your times and the way that your times think. This includes all of this here, our opinions, our maxims, our idioms, the things that we think are self-evident, that they came from bigger than just our traditions, but they came from a force behind that. It's kind of the air we breathe, the times that we live in. And of course, these are hard to see quite often because we are in it. If you ask me, what's it like to be a Caucasian American? I might say, good. But I don't really know how to answer the question. If I ask you, how is it to be an Asian American? You might have some ideas about certain racism that's touched your life, certain perks, certain strange things your mom cooks. But overall, you don't really know because you are. I can see more of your life in some ways than you can see because I'm outside of it, right? And that's kind of the issue with the patterns of the world, as they move through again like yeast. I want to try to chart this for a second and talk about this, and encourage you to go and do more research on your own and think about it. Just in general, I think there are some universal, timeless, transcultural patterns of the world, things that all people at all times have fallen into, things that we step back in history and sociology and look out, we can see these things were moving behind the governments, behind people, behind the arts, and motivating them. And you think about the competition that drives people, and a pattern that is consistent. Competition behind sexism. Who's better, men or women? Behind racism, behind nationalism. The Bible talks that another pattern that goes on is suppression of the truth of God, which in Proverbs famously calls us fools. That's what Paul is saying in Galatians. Foolishness to suppress what God has said. And we suppress what God has said because we rather justify ourselves. But the self parts of the world, the idea that we solve problems with violence has been a consistent pattern. It goes back to Cain. And we see still today, how do we solve our problems? I don't like police officers, shoot them. I don't like those person, kill them. But a consistent pattern of the world and how it goes. But what's important, I think, for us also, because Paul's talking to a specific time, a specific place, I think it's important for us to understand what those are also. And in ours, in general, this is the era that we live in, the time we live in is called the postmodern era, postmodernism. And I urge you, middle school, high school, out of school, research this. Google it, look it up. It's not a Christian world saying that's the way the world acts. This is a general word to say this is the type of time and age that we live in, trying to sum up the way we think, what we desire, and how we got here. And I think it's important, instead of just saying the world is crazy, the world is upside down, we do a lot more to evangelize, to share the gospel when we know our age. Please don't say that generation, this generation. What's going on in our generation and how did we get here? We got here from the older generation and they got there from that generation. Let's make sense out of this instead of just giving up hope. Amen? I won't give you a history lesson, but there's a reason that we are where we are today. This didn't happen overnight. I'll give you one example in this. If you think about where are we today in this upside crazy time when we don't know what gender is. We don't know what gender is. Even though it seems to be the most easily observable difference in humanity and in the animal kingdom. You're male or you're female. But today we don't know. We don't know, or we can't say, or it's fluid. But where did we get that the word gender doesn't mean anything? But we know scientifically it does. We know we are biologically determined. So why are we saying this? Well, there has been a deconstruction of truth. You know, if you split the world into the pre-modern, the modern, and the post-modern, basically, in short, big strokes, the pre-modern world believed in a top-down theory. There was a God. He gave power to a king. The king gave authority to other people. What God said, the king did. What the king said, we followed. Same thing with King David. Amen? And it's the same world. And that was overthrown through the Renaissance and the Enlightenment that took the focus off God and put it on people. Now, there were some good things that came out of this. We're here, American Revolution. The French Revolution, kind of, sort of. But we're here. There was an overthrow of kings and a placement. But what happened is the world became human-centric. And reason became supreme, not transcendental knowledge. But what I can know and what can work. What does that matter? Well, what happened is that if the problem is us, then we can also solve the problem. The problem is ignorance, then we can add education and reason. So problems became human solvable. In the Enlightenment period, we saw materialism, the idea that this is all there is. This is all there is. By the time of the Romantic period here, we saw also Kant saying that knowledge is really unknowable. We can't really sure. We can't really trust our faculties. We can reason to a great point, but even then, we don't know. Come into that existentialism, which said, okay, if we don't really know things, we can't really know things, then we have to create meaning into life. Morality, then, is not absolute. Truth is not absolute. So I need to inject meaning bravely, courageously. I need to write my own script, my own movie. Some of my favorite writers actually fall into this camp, but they're wrong. But in part of that, inside existentialism and what happened in the 19th, 20th century is when we had the idea that truth is a construct, people shot holes in the theory that there is real truth from different angles. Marx is saying, look, there is no truth. There is no real understanding. People are just thinking that, doing that, because they're motivated by economics. Economics can explain what you're thinking, what you're doing. Nietzsche is saying that everything you're saying, every truth claim is actually just a power play. You want to put someone down to put yourself on top. We can't trust anything that you're saying. Nothing matters except you assuming power, and those who get the power are actually those who are correct. Freud is saying, you know what, everything you're claiming, everything you think is real, just a projection of your subconscious and your unconscious, mostly from repressed sexual desires. Even your image of God isn't true. It's projecting the father you wish you always had. You can't trust your feelings or your ideas. Add into that world wars, Holocaust, Vietnam, pollution, and by the 1960s, you have people that are ready to tune out and say, look, we were promised all this progress. We were promised all this reason. We were promised the truth that we could set ourselves free. But the world hasn't paid up. It's gotten worse. And so then let's throw off all intellectual, all moral, all artistic restraints and find our own way. We became, in a sense, at that time, very orphaned as a people with no great story and no great narrative. Individualism. And that opened the door for postmodernism. What are some of the beliefs of it? There's many, but what we're trying to say is, in general, the way that we try to find truth or interpret truth or knowledge. Some of the things that kind of mark us as a people today is that we have this great suspicion of truth, and you can see where that came from. Today, brothers and sisters, Christianity isn't rejected by postmodern people because it's wrong. That happened in the 19th century. And people said, no, science, reason, they don't point to God. Today, it's not that Christianity is wrong. It's that how dare you claim that it's the only truth? How dare you claim that there is truth and that this could be true? That's very different when we talk to an audience. And that's why there's been a deconstruction of truth from every angle. What are you really saying? Why are you saying that? I can't trust it. And come into that is relativism, which says, look, there is no great truth. You have your truth and I have my truth. And you believe what you want and I believe what I want. Even if they contradict, I'll respect your truth and you respect my truth. Which leads us to self-determination. There is no great narrative in life. There is no great truth. I need to determine that for myself. And if all truth is equally valid and I need to determine mine for myself, I need to be able to express that. Which is why in our culture, the great, great taboo has been when you stop somebody from expressing their truth. I need to live my truth. Have you heard that? I need to live my spiritual journey. I need to live out who I feel I am. Feelings have replaced reason, which replaced transcendental truth. Feelings now are the trump card. How do you know that? Why do you believe that? Because I feel that. How do you argue with that? My feelings are my feelings. My truth is my truth. And into that comes this omnipresent, uber principle of tolerance. And tolerance, dictionary-wise, meant I put up with you. I don't like you. I don't believe what you're saying. I don't agree, but I put up with it out of kindness. That's not what tolerance means today. Because if all truth is relative, if I need to determine for myself, if I need to express myself, you don't just tolerate me, you have to accept me. Because tolerate calls into question that I could be wrong. We don't want to be wrong. Universities today, we have safe spaces. We have trigger warnings. We try to remove as much as possible anything that could offend anyone or tell anyone that they're wrong. Where did that come from? Because if you tell me I'm wrong, my worldview shatters. I can't handle debate. I can get into a shouting match, but I don't want to go point by point. Will you tolerate me? Will you accept me? Will you tell me you agree with me? These are some of the principles that are going on today. Another huge one is that when we've pulled away from this, authorial intent has no meaning. When I went to the University of New York, or New York University, in an English literature major, we were taught if you start asking questions, what did the author mean? Who is the author? What's his background? Why would he write this? My professors would say, you are wasting your time. Not only will you never know, it's not important. Be a man. Write in what you think it means, what you want it to mean. Be creative. Look from a lens of feminist, communist, homosexuality. Write your story into that story. Brothers and sisters, do you see the implication? Why does it matter who wrote the book of Acts? Why does it matter what the original audience thought or who it was for? What does it matter to me? Do you see that in our own Bible study? Do you feel that pressure? Okay. What about me? What do I do? This is a product of our times. What's the answer? Where do we go from here? I think it's beautiful that Paul again reminds them in their age, in their time, the answer is adoption. The answer is a change of ownership. That doesn't just point by point dismantle those views, but tells you you're free from the age that is controlling you and from the times. It says, when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, Jesus Christ, born of a woman, fully human, to redeem those who were under the law. The answer is redemption. The answer is salvation. The answer is freedom and liberation through Jesus Christ. Because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts. Brothers and sisters, I think just specifically when we think about postmodernism, we think about the times we're in, we're living in an age again that has been orphaned from its story, that has lost its story. What Paul is saying to Galatians, I think, is the same story that we share today. I know the story. I know where you come from. I know that's offensive to say that I know, but I'm telling you I know. And I know the story, and the story is that there's a God who wants you as his child, who came to save you as his child, not to put you in some hierarchy, not to put levels on who's in and who out, but to come and make you a child. We live in a generation that is orphaned from truth, that's orphaned from its own families, that cries out, I want community, I want intimacy, I want acceptance, I want experience. Come and know God. Has come to adopt you. Look at the intimacy that it says, that we don't just get to know God, but know him where we can call him Abba. We can call him Father in the most intimate way, in the clearest way, in a direct way. And this is what I also think answers our problems today too. He says in verse 8, formerly when you did not know God, you were enslaved to those that by nature are not gods. How do we answer postmodernism? We have to call out its contradiction. There is no truth. There is no absolute truth. Is what you just said true? Words are meaningless. Why you fill textbooks with them? There is no great storyline to life. There is no meta-narrative. Aren't you giving me a meta-narrative? Aren't you controlling my worldview? We're tolerant of everything except intolerance. Does that make you really tolerant? Brothers and sisters, the same answer that Paul had to give to people, same answer. We have to answer lies with truth. We have to answer confusion with rationality from God. It's the same idea that he's saying here. But beautifully here, we live in a world that says we don't know. I can't say. I can't be sure. There either is no truth, or who am I to say, or truth claims are all suspect. What Paul is telling them, what we have to tell the world is, number one, God is knowable. Truth is knowable. The ultimate truth, with a capital T, is a person, and he is knowable. He's not just abstractly knowable or intellectually unknowable. He is a person that we are called into relationship with. He is knowable. But look at this, that's even more amazing. Not only can you know God, not only can truth be known, he knows you. He knows you. And the great principle uncutting the world here is that God has chosen you and come to you, not you coming to him. There's an answer there. God is knowable, and we are actually known by God. And so he asks again and tells us here, you have been free as a church, as a people, from these patterns of the world. Why are you going back? And if he has to say that to them, I think that we have to say that today as a church. Do we see those patterns of the world coming into how we worship God, how we do Bible study, how we think about God, how we welcome each other, how we attract people to church, how we share the truth and engage the truth? I think not only are we kind of in trouble because that the world's patterns are pervasive, they can always be coming into the church, then and now. But there's another problem for us in postmodernism. I wish you guys would raise your hand, but how many of you are actually scared to go share the gospel because people are going to say, that's your truth? You feel that? You feel that? I know, I'm shocked. That's an American problem that we have, and we have to overcome the truth. They're not going to listen to me. They're going to say all things are true. They're going to say I offended them. We're paralyzed from sharing the gospel. We're paralyzed from giving them the very thing they need. And we ourselves are following the patterns of the world. I don't want to offend anybody. I don't want to say my truth is exclusive. You see that? What do we do? Again, Paul tells us in his letters, stand firm, glorify God. Our ultimate goal, our ultimate motivation, our ultimate hope is not that, again, we pity the world and it needs to be saved. The world is being saved to give glory to Jesus Christ, which is a plan that is unstoppable, and it is moving now. My ultimate concern, my ultimate motivation isn't because I want this to be a better place for Yejin and Yedam to grow up in, though I do. My ultimate motivation is not that we have a better America. Ultimate motivation is that Jesus Christ receives glory. Amen? I encourage you again to study and know your times. I know you might not have a leaning towards philosophy or history. Research this through the sciences. Research it through what's happened in our culture. But I encourage you all to get to know some of these people. Even if we don't know them by name, this has trickled down into our culture. Where did this come from? How do we answer it? Paul was a student of his age. He could speak to them because he knew their philosophers. He knew their poets. He knew their beliefs. Right? And I think also we're called to engage, to answer this world. And remember that we're answering people. We're not answering an abstract culture. We're answering people that are lost, that are enslaved. And again, I encourage us as a church that we don't have to condemn this world. We don't have to conform to this world, but all we're called to do is witness, to proclaim the truth to this world. I'll leave you with one final encouragement here. As we remember that Christianity is unpalatable to this world. It always has been and always will be. It turns upside down and right side up again the patterns of this world. We upset it. We disturb it. It wants to cower back into darkness. I don't know if you read next year or coming up, I guess it was just past this week, that now second graders in California will start to learn about same-sex unions and same-sex marriage and the process to normalize it as part of history, as part of regular second graders in California. Patterns of this world will not stop to try to educate and re-educate people. But we have one story. We have one antidote, the truth of Jesus Christ. We have to share it clearly. We have to share it dynamically. We have to proclaim, this is not my truth. This is God's truth. We don't have to be annoying. We don't have to try harder to make enemies, but with courage and faith, with hope of glorifying God, we have to share Christ. Let's pray. Lord, even though we believe that everyone's entitled to their own truth, we know that when people drive buses through crowds, when people are profiled because of their race, even when someone takes our seat on the bus, Lord, we cry foul. We know that there's something wrong. We know that there is a great justice that is beyond ourselves, Lord, and we appeal to you. We appeal to you to speak your righteousness to our generation, to this age, to this time. Help us remember, help us to know, help us to appreciate, to live in the fact that we are now children of God. We have been forgiven and we have been liberated, Jesus, from going back, from operating at the way the world does, whether in legalism or mysticism, in postmodernism. Lord God, you have set us free. We pray again, Holy Spirit, that you continue to encourage us, continue to lead us, that we continue to rely on you for power, for insight, for understanding, to know our new Lord and Master, Jesus Christ. Help us see the opportunities. Help us to have boldness and courage, just like our brother Paul, to go speak to a lost generation. Speak against the powers of this world. We pray in your name.